Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this short lecture I will discuss the breaking stage in developing digital artifacts. Now, this is a somewhat counterintuitive stage, as by this stage you have passed already through observing some sort of reality, defining a problem, ideating possible solutions, prototyping them and testing them with users, with an audience. And the expectation normally is that by this time your media object is somewhat finished, somewhat perfect already. And hence this is counterintuitive, because in effect this stage involves breaking these assumptions. This is the stage where your assumptions have been corrected by users and the medium with which you work, and you discover in effect in this stage that you have to keep iterating through the media making process. You have to start anew, as it were. This stage and the following stage, the stage of remaking, is where you really discover the value of the fist, the fast, inexpensive, simple, tiny, and fearful, the fail, early fail, often concepts, and as in terms of both ways of thinking and ways of doing your project. So this is a more conceptual stage, because it involves analyzing the entire process so far and the reality in which you are creating, in which you are working, and trying consciously to break your assumptions, to break your model, and orienting yourself anew. So for the remainder of this short lecture, I'll be trying to map how this process works in terms of our mindset and how it works in terms of possible practice. So the first thing that we need to emphasize is that we operate, when it comes to our being in a reality, we operate by creating models of that reality, and using these models to perceive it and to act within it. And these models can be very simple, like stencils, or can be very complex models of reality that try and predict what might happen if we do this or that. But the problem is, in both cases, that the world is not complex, the world is complicated. And what this means in practice is that even with a very complex model of a reality, model predicting something, you're still operating in a very linear way of thinking about the world. Linear way here stands for the fact that you're operating using some sort of cause and effect modeling. If I do this, this would happen, and if I do that, that something else would happen. The problem here is that the world is complicated in that it is non-linear, always already non-linear. And this means that it's all sorts of a priori, so by definition, unpredictable phenomena happening, which wreck all models. And this is a really important thing to understand, because in our complex civilization, we are continuously seduced by the use of models. And we're continuously seduced by the appeal of modeling reality and acting according to established models, or taking for granted models that are given to us by an authority figure. And the problem is that the world is always far more complicated than the models which are trying to explain it. So this is a really important thing to keep in mind a priori, so before you even start acting and planning in reality. I also want to remind you of this motto that we discussed in the lecture on testing, where the argument was that when you prototype, you're trying to create a number of different instantiations of whatever it is you're working on. It is, your project can be literally anything. So you have to prototype presuming that what you're doing is correct and right, and will result in some sort of desirable change, right, that you're planning for. But when you're testing, you have to expect that reality will correct your assumptions, right? So hence why you need to test presuming you're wrong. And this is, again, really important. And this mindset of testing while presuming that your assumptions will be correct, that your model was wrong, continues and extends when it comes to the breaking stage. And this can be explained in another way through this quote by Mark Hatch from the Make a Move Manifesto, when he talks about building a theory to fit the observation, not trying to fit observations to existing theories. This is, again, a really important distinction that is far too often either forgotten or completely ignored by many people, unfortunately by many people who ought to know better. What this stands for is a way of thinking which we call inductive thinking, which stands for building the whole out of observable parts, as opposed to trying to fit observable parts into some sort of pre-existing whole. The importance of this approach is that if you are approaching some sort of reality and observable effects with a pre-existing model which acts as a stencil, you will and trying to fit everything that you've observed into that model by definition, then you will have to ignore a lot of that reality, or you have to pretend it acts in a certain way while it doesn't, right? So in effect, your model is always already fake, right? It is always already imprecise because it ignores a lot of the observation. It's trying to forcefully fit them. Whereas what Mark Hatch is pointing at here is the diametrical opposite, where you are starting with no assumptions, you're observing phenomena, you're observing some effects, and you're trying to build a theory out of these effects in order to fit what you're observing, as opposed to fitting what you're observing to an existing theory. Again, we will return to this. This is a really important distinction. And the way to move forward after you've closed that loop, so you've closed the loop from observation through ideation, definition, prototyping and testing, is to keep trying to interact in a variety of ways with our environment, right? And I want to emphasize this point of that John Boyd here, who is a legendary military theorist, makes, which is that it's important to have a variety of ways, so to force yourself to try a variety of new things continuously, right? Because this is the only sure way to discern and observe reality in its complicatedness, right? So even if it's all the same, even if everything dictates that you do the same thing, here the dictum is that you need to try and do it differently, simply because this is likely to generate some new effects that you have not observed before that might teach you more about this reality, right? So this is a proactive stance. This is a exploratory, inquisitive stance, as opposed to a passive stance in which you're just going through the operations dictated by an existing model. The first stance of active inquisitiveness, which forces you to try new things, is also quite risky, right? Whereas being safe within the confines of an existing model is obviously quite safe, because the model dictates you act like this, you act like this. It's passive though, right? And what this means in practice is that when reality invariably changes, and it will, because reality is complicated, right? And it will change in ways unpredictable by the model, you will be left in a state of total surprise by that new configuration of reality, right? Which the model could not foresee. And the reason why we need to be in that proactive, risky stance of trying new things, as John Boyd argues, is that so that we can generate mental images or impressions that correspond to that world, right? So in order to map that complicatedness of the world, you need to keep trying to examine it in a new way, right? You need to keep trying new things. And what this means in practice is that you need to continuously decide on some sort of new way of doing things, and you need to quickly enact it, right? So this is this rapid prototyping mindset. Actions must be taken over and over again in many different ways. You need to keep monitoring and determining the precise nature of the actions needed in order to keep iterating through that process. And you need to be able to form these mental concepts of observed reality as you perceive, in order to be able to change these concepts as reality itself appears to change, right? So this is a process of continuous mapping to the complicated and ever-changing nature of reality when it comes to your project, whatever it is that you're doing. And the key perspective here, in my opinion, illustrating the best this mindset that we're trying to map and understand, is that when your model is broken, when things go out of whack, in other terms, either willingly by you or by reality in a non-negotiable way, this is the time, the only time, literally, where you see something new and strange, right? If something is new, it means it was not predicted by the model. If it's strange, it means it was not predicted by your model of reality, of how things were supposed to be happening. And that is also literally the only time when you learn something. This is the only time when you are likely to discover a new way of doing things, right? Or you are likely to have an important learning moment when it comes to your presumed way of doing things. So when things go out of whack, that's when we see something new and strange, and that is when we learn something. And this is the essence of this moment of this moment that I want to focus on in this lecture, breaking as a mindset. So what does this mindset involve? It involves, first and foremost, presuming your assumptions about how things are and how they should be are wrong, right? So you have to presume that your model is imprecise and wrong. It might help you do things in a certain way, but it does not describe reality. And it will be invariably corrected by reality. So you have to have that distance from your model. Unfortunately, this is a completely alien concept to most people. Most people are not only wedded to their models of reality, they have built their entire identities around the models of reality they have adopted. And that's always already a terrible, terrible proposition. Why? Because when that model is wrecked by ever-changing nature of reality, their very identities are at stake, right? So you can see this is an existential issue actually here. And breaking as a mindset allows you to leave that losing proposition and adopt a very proactive stance. And we already talked about this earlier in another lecture when we talk about Eric Raymond's dictum, release early, release often, right, in the context of software, that he had this argument there that the most striking and innovative solutions come when you realize that your concept of the problem was wrong, your model of reality was actually wrong, right? And when you realize that and you fully take this on board and own it, that's when the interesting solutions come, the interesting propositions. So what I'm describing here in a very roundabout way, in order to allow you to map this to all sorts of different concepts, is a process which has two stages, analysis and synthesis. So for our intents and purposes, we call this breaking and remaking, right? So when it comes to analysis, you start with a whole, which is your model of reality, or your model of a problem for that matter, and you break it down into constituent parts, and you try and break it down as much as possible. And then when it comes to synthesis, you build these parts, right, while keeping in mind that mindset of abandoning the model, of breaking it. You build these parts into a new whole, and that's a new model, that's a synthesis. And this is a continuous process of analyzing and synthesizing, right? This is not something that you start once, you go through once in order to build the perfect model, because again, all models are by definition wrong. So Let's focus on analysis. This lecture is only about focusing on this stage, the stage of breaking. So for our intensive purposes, to keep this simple, analysis stands for pulling things apart, pulling some sort of existing reality apart into its constituent pieces. So let's use a very simple and straightforward example. This is an example, by the way, that John Boyd uses in his argument on analysis and synthesis. So you have these three scenarios, which most of us have encountered in one way or another. So let's say you have first scenario is someone riding a motorbike through the city. The second scenario is someone water skiing being pulled by a motorboat somewhere. And then finally you have some sort of all-terrain vehicle, or you could substitute this for a tank if you want, going here. In this case, this is an all-terrain vehicle going through the frozen tundra somewhere in Siberia, presumably. So what does breaking involve here? What does analysis involve here? And it literally involves, for intents and purposes, pulling things apart, right? So how does this work? So take the motorbike, you're pulling it apart. So you have constituent parts, you have wheels, you have handlebars, you have a seat, you have an engine, right? Then you have the water skis and the motorboat. So you have skis, you have a boat, you have an outboard engine, right? You have some sort of wheel, etc., etc. Then we have the all-terrain vehicle. So we have tracks, you have again an engine, you have some sort of wheel again, presumably, and it's something that is stored in the vehicle. So you have gone through the process now of pulling apart these scenarios, these situations, into their constituent elements. So what you are left with is a bunch of completely unrelated elements, standing apart, right? So we have wheels and handlebars and seat and skis and an outboard motor and a boat and tracks and some sort of protective shell, etc. And these are unrelated elements. Right, so your analysis is complete here. You've broken down these models, these operating frames, into constituent elements. And now comes the synthesis part, which is the second part, the remaking part of this process, where you're putting things together in a new way. Right, so this stage involves trying to create a new model of reality, to use our the level at which we're operating. We're talking about models of reality, but this can be a new model of how your project should look like, right? Out of these constituent elements that you've just isolated, because again, you pulled things apart, right? So you went through a process of analysis and now you're starting a process of synthesis. So what does this process involve? You're trying to fit things together in a new way, right? A new promising way. So here is how this works in our case study. So you have the handlebars of the motorbike, we decide to use them. We have the seat, we decide to use it. We have the skis, we decide to use it, to use the skis. We have an outboard motor, which we also can make use of. And then we have the tracks of the all-terrain vehicle. So what we are left with, in effect, when we combine these elements, disparate elements, I underline again, into a new whole, is a snowmobile, right? And now, this is a really important point, which is even people who go through this example often overlook. The snowmobile is not some sort of naturally evolved technology that, for example, originates from skis or originates from all-terrain vehicles, right? Or from anything else naturally occurring before. Right, it's a purely synthetic phenomenon, right, which is synthesized from these disparate elements. And this is really important to understand, because again, model thinking dictates invariably, and this is the danger of model thinking, when you use models only to think and you're wedded completely to model, your identity is built around using a model of reality, which is maybe shared by many others, and that's why you're using it in order to fit in that reality. Model thinking is always linear. right? So the seduction here is to predict some sort of linear developments, to expect some sort of linear evolution of something into something slightly different. So the same, but a little bit different. But when you leave model thinking behind, and you fully take on board these arguments around analysis and synthesis, you suddenly are able to create this kind of completely new realities. In effect, you know, you suddenly can make snowmobiles. So, breaking as a mindset, what does this involve? First and foremost, again, presuming your assumptions about how things are and should be are wrong. Second, a creative destruction of one's own structures, right? So one's own models of reality, if we're thinking in terms of a mindset. One's own way of seeing things and expecting things and predicting things. You should be always ready to literally creatively destroy it, pull it apart, and recombine it again in a new way, in an interesting way. And so this process is ongoing. It's a continuous process, and continuity here is a key word, right? So it's the breaking as a mindset is a process of ongoing continuous analysis of perceived reality, right? When it comes to mindset, you're continuously thinking about what you're observing, and you're reevaluating your models. You're trying to pull them apart, and the subsequent stage is obviously to put them back together in interesting ways, to synthesize a new model. When it comes to the process itself, though, there are some very interesting parallels with the software industry. And again, this maps to what we have been sort of discussing in earlier lectures in this cycle about the internet paradigm, which is the openness of the process of creation and the quick iteration, the quick feedback loops, and the ability to manipulate the process itself, to continuously review the process. So there is this concept in the software industry called continuous deployment, and it literally involves breaking as a continuous process. So it involves many small incremental daily updates which are happening continuously. Like, few people know that, for example, Netflix, the platform that most of you will be familiar with, if not everyone, is undergoing thousands of updates every day. Every day. Right, so these are continuous, small, incremental updates in the software that happen constantly, right? So instead of the model staying the same until some sort of catastrophic change is necessary, right? So notice the big difference. The model is continuously reevaluated, continuously presumed to be broken and inadequate, and continuously patched. That's what continuous deployment actually stands for. And this also applies to all other big internet companies. So Amazon, Google, Facebook, they all do exactly the same thing. They are all undergoing and have deployed as paradigmatic, as default, this process of continuous deployment, which involves continuous incremental updates to the software, to the platform. The second part, the second example here, is what is known again in the software industry as agile development, which stands for short deployment cycles and continuous iteration. And if you've been paying attention so far in the cycle of lectures, this should be all very familiar to you, because we've been explaining exactly this in a different way. So you have continuous iteration through continuous deployment, and very short deployment cycles, which are intended to last a day, and then again everything continues unabatedly. There is no point at which the process is presumed to be complete. There is no point at which the model is complete, is presumed to be perfect, right? Everything is continuously being rewoven, broken, and reassembled again. And then finally, there is this notion of decentralized decision making, which is also crucial. Right, especially if you're working in a team. What it stands for is that each and every member of the team, and in this case, developers, the people in the software industry, the people who write the code, have to be involved in the full deployment cycle. They cannot be somehow separated from the testing stage where their code actually encounters reality and is corrected, correcting their assumptions, correcting their model of reality. So what this stands for in practice is that each and every member of the team which is working on that project has to be having some sort of skin in the game and has to be able to correct their assumptions of reality. So has to be able to observe how their input in the project, how whatever assumption they built in into the content or whatever the project is encountering reality, is going through the testing stage and is being corrected, right? So what we have in effect is these three elements in which all form part of this concept of breaking the process. Continuous deployment, many small incremental daily updates, agile development, so short deployment cycles, continuous iteration, this happens daily, decentralized decision making, everyone involved in the project is involved in the full deployment cycle. There is no, even though there is separation of responsibilities and competencies, everyone is on the receiving end of the testing stage where they can observe how the assumptions are being corrected, right? And in effect, when you take this all as a whole, from a developer's perspective, which is the perspective that you listening to this lecture you are all involved in some sort of digital artifact and sort of project, from a developer's perspective, the project appears to be broken and impermanent, Peter. The project is permanently in need of updates, continuous iteration, small incremental changes, right? It's permanently broken, right? And this is first and foremost, as we emphasized, a mindset. And secondly, it is a process of a way of doing things. It's a methodology. So again, to sum it up, we have breaking as a mindset and breaking as a process. And both of them together are crucial because when things go out of whack, we can see something new and strange, and that is when we learn something. If you have any questions, hit me up on Twitter @TedMitiu. Thank you all for listening and see you online.